When you decide to become a pilot, you need to learn a whole new vocabulary. And then if you decide to become an airline pilot, it's another set of words that you have to learn. In this video, I'm going to tell you some of the key words and phrases that you'll need when you go to the airlines. Coming up. Hey 7-4 crew, welcome back. If you don't know me, my name's Kelsey. I'm a 747 pilot. My channel, 7-4 Gear, is all about aviation. So whether you're a pilot or an aviation enthusiast, consider subscribing. In this video, I'm talking about 10 words or phrases that you're gonna need if you decide to go to the airlines. Before you ask, yes, I did just get over a cold, and that's why I'm currently in what I call my James Earl Jones stage of recovery. It seems when I get sick, for the next day or two after I start to get better, I go through this James Earl Jones stage where my voice gets a lot deeper.
I am the father.
A movie a lot of pilots and aviation enthusiasts really enjoy is Catch Me If You Can, starring Leonardo DiCaprio. If you've seen that movie, you might remember this scene.
You turning around on the red eye?
I'm jumping puddles for the next few months trying to earn my keep running leapfrogs for the weak and weary.
He's basically showing up and he's pretending to be a pilot in this scene. And when he shows up, he starts throwing out a bunch of aviation jargon. Now, currently, a lot of pilots don't use those words. So if you showed up into a cockpit now and started saying those things, all the pilots would look at you and go, what? Anyway, I'll put a link to the Catch Me If You Can video in the description below. But let's get into some of these aviation terms. So I have 10 different aviation terms that we're gonna go over. And before I get into that, I wanna clear up one that I get asked about a lot in the comment section. It's keep the blue side up. That's not something that you're gonna hear a lot of pilots say to each other while we're out flying around, but essentially what it means is I'm talking about the artificial horizon that you'll see in most cockpits. The sky is gonna be blue and the land is gonna be brown. And basically what it's meaning is keep aware of what's going on around you. Let's say you get into the clouds and you're a new pilot and you get disoriented. It's very easy to get disoriented if you're not used to flying in the clouds. And what has happened in the past is pilots get confused and they can get all the way inverted upside down.
Because I was inverted.
Obviously, if you've inverted your Cessna or your plane that you're learning to fly on and you're completely upside down, that's gonna be a bad situation. Stay aware of what's going on around you and make sure that you are flying the right side up. All right, let's go into these words here. So the first word I'm gonna cover is another thing that I get asked about a lot. Why do you call the channel 7-4 Gear? Well, I'm a 747 pilot. So generally speaking, all Boeing pilots are going to drop the last seven off of the equipment that they're flying. And that's because every Boeing aircraft ends with a 7. So 727, 737, 747, and so on. The only exception to that rule is the 777. So you'll hear a pilot say, hey man, what are you flying? Oh, I'm on the 73. Or another example will be, yeah man, I fly the 74 for this airline. That will be an example of what pilots would say to each other and they drop that last 7 off. Again, the only exception would be if you're flying the 777. It would be the exact same thing. Yeah man, I fly the 777 for this airline. Number two, jump seat. Jump seat is an additional seat that's on the flight deck. There's two ways that this word gets used. The first one is if you're referring to just the seat itself. Again, it's just an additional seat, and in every cockpit, it's different. If you remember in that clip, Catch Me If You Can, Leonardo DiCaprio is kind of looking around. He's looking around and trying to find the jump seat. And that's because on every aircraft, the jump seat's in a different position. So if you're trying to find it, it can be a bit confusing, and nobody wants to look like they're the new guy and is unfamiliar with what's going on. So he's looking around, trying to figure out where it is, because sometimes it's slid in somewhere, or it has a weird release for you to be able to get it out. And it's different in every flight deck. If you ever end up on a flight deck and you're at the airlines and you're riding the jump seat, the captain or the first officer will say, are you familiar? If you're not familiar, meaning you haven't been on that flight deck before, it's better just to say, no, I've never been up here before. There's no harm in it. And what they'll do is they'll show you how to get the jump seat out, how to stow the jump seat in an emergency, and go over all the safety features that are in the cockpit. It'll take you 1 minute, and it's better than saying, yeah, I know, and you don't know, and then you look really stupid because now you've just lied to the guys. So your jump seat is the seat, and it's also if you're trying to get home or get to work. And how that works is, in the airlines, if you're trying to get to work or get home, you can list yourself for a flight with any given airline in the US, if you're a US airline pilot. If there's a seat in the back, you can go and ride in the seat in the back. If there is no seat in the back, because you are a crew member, you're able to ride up in the cockpit. And riding up there, you're going to sit in the jump seat. That jump seat is usually pretty uncomfortable, but if you're just trying to get home or get to work, you don't really mind. You're just trying to get there. So what you'll hear is a guy say, I'm gonna jump seat home, or I'm gonna jump seat to work. And that basically means I don't have a seat reserved for me in the back, and I'm gonna try to catch a free flight. Whether you're gonna ride in the front or the back, they'll refer to it as the jump seat. Number three, deadhead. Deadhead is when your airline is gonna be moving you from one location to another location. And usually that's to operate a flight or to get you back to your base. So deadhead means that you, either by yourself or with your crew, will have a seat in the back. It's paid for by the airline. And basically what you're gonna do is show up and check in like a normal passenger, and you're gonna sit in the back. And that is a deadhead. Number four, legs. Legs are gonna refer to the number of flights that you're doing in a given day. So you might hear a pilot say, yeah, I gotta do a two-leg day. And basically what that means is he's doing two flights that day. He might go Miami to Charlotte and Charlotte to Detroit, as an example. And that would be a two-leg day. At the regionals, you'll hear pilots say, you know, I got a four-leg day or a five-leg day. And that means they're doing five different flights that day. So the legs is always referring to the number of flights that you're doing in a given day. Number five, RJ. RJ means regional jet. So you'll hear pilots say ERJ or CRJ. That's gonna be either the Embraer or the Bombardier aircraft. So for an example, I would say, yeah, when I was flying RJs. Now I'm not saying CRJ or ERJ, I'm just saying back when I was flying RJs. And that's generally what pilots will say. For the most part, guys don't specify unless they're getting into the specifics of a topic. They'll say, yeah, when I was flying the RJs, or I fly an RJ for this airline. So RJ means regional jet. Number six, upgrade time. Your upgrade time is the time that it's gonna take you to be a first officer and upgrade to captain. So that's gonna vary depending on the airline and the aircraft. You might have on a smaller aircraft, an upgrade time might be 1 or 2 or maybe 3 years. On a larger aircraft, it might be 10 or 15 years to become a captain on that aircraft. That upgrade time is gonna vary depending on the airline and the aircraft. So at the same airline, you could have a 1 year upgrade time on one aircraft and a 15 year upgrade on a different aircraft. So that's the upgrade time. So you will hear a pilot say something like, yeah, I got my paperwork in for upgrade, I'm still waiting to hear back. Or, I've had my paperwork in for upgrade for 2 years, and I think in the next 2 or 3 months I should be able to upgrade. So the upgrade is basically going from a first officer to a captain. Number seven, flight attendants, FA. Generally, pilots aren't saying, and flight attendants aren't saying FAs when they're talking about themselves, but they use it a lot in text. As an example, a flight attendant could leave her bag or her purse or a hat or something on the plane. And if that crew's already left and you knew the pilots, you could text one of them and say, hey man, one of your FAs left their bag on the plane. And that is when they're talking amongst themselves, or you'll see a lot of times in forums, pilots will say FA, they're referring to flight attendant. Number eight, bingo fuel. If you remember in the film review I did on American Made starring Tom Cruise, I talk about when the Border Patrol is following him and they say, we're bingo, we need to go back to base. Basically what a bingo fuel number is, you are going to have a number at which you have to go back and land. Most of the times if you go to the airlines, your bingo fuel number is gonna be more calculated for when you need to go to your alternate. As an example, you're flying from Chicago to Denver. You get to Denver and the weather is bad and they put you into a hold. So you're just doing circles over the airport. At that point, you're going to look at what is your fuel burn and how much fuel is it gonna take you to go from Denver to your alternate. Let's say Colorado Springs, which is just to the south. So what will happen is you'll calculate what your fuel burn is now and what you're gonna need to get there. And then you're gonna say 20,000 pounds, that's our bingo fuel. And what that means is when your aircraft gets to 20,000 pounds, you're gonna tell air traffic control, we're bingo fuel and we're going to our alternate. So that's basically a decision point. So now you know how much time you have to play with, and you'll start looking at some ways to be more fuel efficient. And you might even let air traffic control know, hey, we got 10 minutes until we're gonna need to divert. They know if they can slide you in, they'll get you in as a priority. So that's bingo fuel. Number nine, sterile cockpit. Now in the movie review that I did for Flight, I talked about how Denzel broke Sterile Cockpit and he was making a joke. And in the Sully movie, I didn't really talk about it, but Sully did as well break Sterile Cockpit because he's talking about the Hudson. Sterile Cockpit means if you're below 10,000 feet or you're taxiing around at the airport, you're only gonna be talking about things that are related to the safety of flight. And that is because while you're taxiing, there's a lot of dangers to have a runway incursion, or make a mistake and go down the wrong taxiway, or while you're climbing out after takeoff, it's very important that you're listening to what the other planes are doing around you because it's a very congested area. So sterile cockpit is a rule that got put into place that below 10,000 feet, you have to be really aware of what's happening around you. Now, from time to time, you will have pilots that will violate that rule, and they'll be talking about something that's not necessarily related to what's going on. And in that example, Sully's doing that. He's looking at the Hudson and he's saying, you know, what a nice day it is. But technically speaking, below 10,000 feet, you're not supposed to talk about anything that is not related to the safety of flight. So you'll hear things like gear up or select a heading. Anything like that, you're allowed to talk about. You just can't talk about other things. After 10,000 feet, you can talk about whatever you want. That's sterile cockpit. Number 10, turns. Turns or out and backs are what pilots and flight attendants refer to depending on the type of flying that they're doing. As an example, you're in Chicago, you're going to Denver, and then you're going back to Chicago. So when you're in Chicago, if you're talking to another crew member that you see on the jet bridge or walking by, they may ask, hey, what are you doing? And they would say, oh, I'm doing a Denver turn. So by saying you're doing a Denver turn, you're leaving Chicago, going to Denver, and you're gonna turn and come right back. So when you say turn or an out and back, it's always meaning you're having at least two legs because you're going somewhere and coming right back. That's what a turn is. All right, crew, there's 10 words or phrases I think are gonna be really important for you to know if you decide to go to the airlines. In the comment section below, let me know a word or phrase you think a lot of people don't understand or one that you don't know or you want some clarification on. If there's enough in there, maybe we'll make a part 2 to this video. I look forward to hearing from you. Until then, keep the blue side up.